Hello, welcome to Let's Talk. I am Marta.
I'm Wanda.
I'm Sue.
And I'm Jessica. Today we are going to talk about the importance of reading. Ms. Marta is going to read our scripture for today, and we're just going to get right on into it because reading is important.
Yes.
I had a little hard time, I have to say, to find a scripture that could be suitable. Not because there's not scripture about this, because I want it to be kind of like, we could use this for different meanings. So I found Psalm 119, verse 105. Your word is a lamp for my feet, a light of my path. And of course, when we talk about this, we're talking about God's word. But reading, it's a lamp for everybody.
Yes,
it opens doors to many things. It's a way of looking. It's a way of looking at reading that it will open your eyes to many things that you probably wouldn't ever, ever be able to see or know. So the Word of God definitely does that, but also other sorts of books do that. So reading, sometimes people think, well, let me ask you something before I say this. Do you like to read?
Yes, I love to read.
You like to read? Sue, do you like to read?
I really don't. Not casual reading. I'm more into journals and that sort, you know, periodic sort of things rather than, you know, reading
like
novels.
That.
And
I mean, I don't read journals. Don't
but I do read. I mean, I have to read.
Jessica, do you like to read?
Yeah, I like to read. And when you had brought up about the scripture, the one scripture that came up to my mind, which your scripture was really good, and I'm sure Wanda couldn't help me with this one. The lack, what is it? People perish for the lack
for
of
knowledge. That's
and
right.
So when, you know, when we think about reading, especially with the world today, with technology, kids being on their smartphones and iPads and different things like that, we have lost the touch of actually picking up a book and reading it.
Yeah.
A lot of people don't do that anymore. And I just wanted to say that I work at the library, at Union County Library here in New Albany. And I've been there, it'll be a year, sometime this week, on the 13th, I'll be there a year. And I would have never thought, you all, that as a young girl loving to read, that I would work at the library and that it would be a passion of mine. Like, when I say I love working at the library, I love working at the library. And one of the reasons is because we are modern. You know, we have the internet, and I'm getting ready to start teaching computer classes. But also to see the love of reading from the adults and also the children. We have story time every Wednesday at 10 o'clock. So many things about reading. But if we don't continue to read, we will perish because there is
so much information.
So much information, and we don't have the knowledge that we need.
Well, I have a confession. I love to read, but I actually like audiobooks. I'm just gonna be honest with you.
We do.
The audiobooks, that's how I read.
See, I don't.
Yes, and I want it to read to me. Now, I don't like just reading just like love stories. That's not my genre. You know what
so
I'm saying?
So what do you like to
read? I love action, crime, murder, she wrote.
I like that.
You know, I want something that's captivating. You know, the love stories, I mean, yeah, whatever. But I want something that's a crime. You know, action is worse.
I used to love the books of Agatha Christie. I mean, that tells you how old I am, you know. But the mystery and the detective and that kind of thing I like. One thing I can tell you, I do not like to read in the Kindle or audiobooks.
Oh, I love it.
I love the feeling of the of the pages.
Yeah.
I have to have it. I have to underline and write a little something on the side. I'm that type of person. So I don't, you know, this Kindle thing, which people think is really good and really modern.
Kindle.
No.
Yeah, but I mean, you cover so much more. I mean, you do, because I can sit there, you know, instead of listening to music, I would rather listen to a book. I mean, you know, you could do this all day long instead of, you know, because a lot of times you don't have the time to just sit down and just read the book. I mean, I don't. I'm a busy person. Like, I'm going here, I'm going there, I'm going there, you know, and then by the time I get to bed, I'm ready to go to sleep. You know, I don't want to read. And so, therefore, when I'm up and I'm, you know, getting ready for work or something, I have my music, I mean, you know, my book in my ear, and I can
That's
listen
good.
To
she
it.
Has her book
while
in
I'm
her ear.
I do. Yeah. I got it in my ear because, you know, I got my little earpiece in, or while I'm going down the road, you know, I can listen
That's
to a
good
book.
Thing.
Yeah.
If you're going down the road and you want to relax and you want to learn something, stick that CD in there
and listen
to it. Yes. You know, that's absolutely great. We like quotes and stuff like that, mm-hmm. right? So I have one here from Jacqueline Kennedy that says, "There are many little ways to enlarge your world. Love of books is the best of all."
That's mm-hmm. right.
So we can enlarge our thinking and our ways in so many, many, many ways mm-hmm. when we read. And it's very important, and I wanted to make a point today. I've worked with children all my life. That's what I've done. So I want to make the point today to say the importance of starting to read to children at a very early age. Mm-hmm. I started to read to my daughter when she was like 3 months.
Wow.
And she devours books. I mean, you know, she loves books. By the age of 11, she was reading Anne Frank. You know, she just reads a lot, and I think it has a lot to do with the fact that we started reading from a very early age. Of course, there were simple books, you know, one-word books, stuff like that. But it's very important to go to the library, to help them check out a book, to buy books instead of buying so many toys. Just buy a collection of books that you can sit with them. And the most incredible times that I have with my daughter was to sit her in my lap and read. Or before she went to sleep, to read to her.
Yeah.
And the good thing is she's doing that with my grandchildren.
Yeah,
they read a lot to them.
Well,
so.
I want to ask something, you know, since Jessica worked at the library, because I know that a lot of things now is electronic. Mm-hmm. You know, we're doing everything. Do y'all have a lot of kids that come in and check out books there?
Man, do we?
For real?
We have a lot of children that come in with their parents. It's a couple of kids that have personally touched my heart, because as soon as they walk in, they say, "Hey, Miss Jessica," they speak to the staff, and they know exactly what book they want to go to. They know exactly what they want to read. Mm-hmm. So it's a lot of children. The library is very important. A lot of people don't realize that, but it's very important for the kids, for the adults. It's just a very important place. But yeah, we have a lot of children that come in, and it's amazing that you brought that up, because I remember when I was younger, I had a pastor by the name of Pastor Leotis Connor, and every Saturday he would take us to the library, and he taught us how to check out books, how to go by the decimal, the Dewey Decimal, excuse me. And I remember those days of going in, and you know, as a child, those things do come into play. You do remember that. So I remember my boss asked me a question. She said, "Do you know about how to do this and everything? Because you know, you just here, you know, you're at the library." And I explained to her to a T exactly how to do it, because it was taught to me as a young child.
Wow.
And there was a controversy that just happened a couple of weeks ago with the internet. And somebody made a good point. If you sat your children down and read a book, you wouldn't even know about this. Children need to read, and it does start at an early age. And when you were talking about crime and love and history and all that, you can find all that in the Bible.
Yeah, that's true. Everything.
You can find everything in the Bible. And there are so many Bibles that, you know, study Bibles, the King James, and then you have your study Bibles that can help you understand
the Bible.
The Bible. So that way when you read it, you don't just look at it, "Oh, as David. Who is David?" You can imagine, because you're expanding your mind, that David danced before the Lord. You know, he hid in the caves. You know, it's just different things if you make them into characters. So whenever you get into any book, you can imagine in your mind how it just looks, how it could feel if you were that person on that train running away or getting away from crime. Most times the book is better than the movie that they make. Like The Color Purple, for example. I told people several times, for the ones that have never seen it, it's a good movie. Color Purple is a good movie. But the book is even better because it goes into so much detail. And it gives you that mind to be open. So I love to read. Do I read a lot now? No, because I'd be so busy. But audiobooks, like Wanda had brought up, is a good thing.
It is.
But I do challenge... Oh, excuse me, Miss Marty. You
no,
go ahead.
I'm sorry.
No, because I know that reading is your passion, too.
No, no. As a girl, it was not. I thought it was really boring. Really, really boring. And I think that happens to a lot of kids, because they got to read all this stuff for school. Now I find it fascinating. But like some of us, we have a particular like to read. I mean, you don't like everything, you know. But I want to say this quote. It says, reading is to mind what exercise is for the body.
That's right.
So if you I worry sometimes that I might get Alzheimer's, you know, and my mind will go. I don't know. As you get older, you start thinking of these things. So exercise your mind. And one of the ways to exercise
is
your
reading.
So that's something that you can do. Mm-hmm. It doesn't have to be a book this big. We have a member of our church, Miss Virginia Burks, a lady that I just love. She's like 92 years old. Miss Virginia, she doesn't watch his TV. All she does is read.
Oh, wow.
Read. I mean, she devours those books.
Mm-hmm.
So reading is a way for you to keep up to date.
Yeah.
Is a way of keeping your mind
fresh.
Mm-hmm. And for children in particularly, I like to mention that as I research a little bit this, why is it important to read to the kids? First of all, it helps to know them to know the sounds of the words as they're smaller. It helps with words and language. It develops early literacy skills. It sparks the imagination. Like you said, when I read and I talk about the train and the train goes choo-choo, or I think about that pirate that is going with the swords, you know, that imagination. And then you ask that child, what are you thinking? How do you do it? Let's do it in a dramatic play.
Right.
So there's so many things that you can do with books.
Right.
So I'm going to not say that.
Well, I was just going to say, you had something that's good here, Miss Sue. You want to share that, what you got?
Well, actually,
that's cute.
This probably is not related at all, but it's similar to reading in that we are preparing our children to be as good a people as they can be, and you do that by learning, you do that by example as well. And as I said, I'm not a real crazy person about going to the library, but I do go there for various reasons.
Yes, ma'am.
But I lost my train of thought. I'm sorry.
That's
I looked at her and lost my train of thought.
You were just talking about how you don't go to the library a lot.
But I remember, you know, I have worked away from out of the home for many, many years, and my children always had the benefit of being with me in the car for long periods of time.
Mm-hmm.
So we always had, and this was back during the cassette tape times, all the different stories. So they may not have had mother's words saying the stories, but they have all the primary type stories and Bible stories, this sort, they would listen to multiple times because that was our way of reading at that time. And nowadays, I mean, reading is so important and so emphasized by everybody from the First Lady down to, well, to all of us for that matter. In fact, a few weeks ago, I heard our Secretary of State, Delbert Hosemann, say that whether a child is able to read proficiently at the third grade level was part of a formula that was used to calculate how many prison beds we would need. Because reading is that important.
Wow.
Because without being able to read, that child finds themselves alienated from groups that are reading and surpassing them.
Yeah.
And then they have to go to other things because they're not able to do the usual go out and have an interview for a job and this sort of, this was how he was explaining it to us.
And it
makes sense. And you know, they're acting out in ways that they might not have if they had been able to develop that basic skill of reading.
Right.
That comes early, as you said, third grade.
Yeah,
and if you can't do it by third grade, you're behind.
And you're supposed to start reading in preschool stage. The first 5 years of a kid are the most important ones.
Yeah.
Because that's where everything starts to hook up and work and this kind of thing. So if you stimulate their minds and stimulate their cognitive development through reading, through new words, through new things, that's just going like, wow.
Right.
So when they go to school.
And there are measures that, I mean, your children, even at very young age, like 15, 18 months of age, there's a standard that you can compare to your child to see if they're progressing with their language like they should. Like by 18 months, they should be able to sound off 50 words.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they may not be big old words, but there are sounds, and there has meaning to that child for him to be able to verbalize it.
Right.
When we were in school, when I was in school, definitely that was not done like that.
Mm-hmm. Right.
But the kids right now, in order to get out of kindergarten, mm-hmm. you have to be able to do this and this and this. And
before
now you said
it's
about third grade. Mm-hmm. If not, you're back, and that's going to be a disadvantage for them as they go on in school, because they're going to feel left out, self-esteem is down, and that's going to bring a lot of problems.
Right. What were you about to say, Jessica?
I just was listening to you all, and you know, reading to children is important.
Mm-hmm.
Before I say anything else, it is. But you all working at the library, and we talked about being a volunteer.
Mm-hmm.
You all, it's a lot of adults here,
mm-hmm.
of all cultures, that don't know how to read.
Mm-hmm.
And at the literacy council, excuse me, Miss Nancy Meacham needs a lot of volunteers.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm actually going to be one of them, because I want people to know the importance of reading.
Yes.
And I look at adults, and I'm thinking, how did you go through school and not read? What teacher passed you, you don't know how to read?
Mm-hmm.
That you're reading the little golden books, which is something that little kids read, and I'm seeing full adults with grandchildren
mm-hmm.
having to learn how to read from these books. But the one thing I will say about the Literacy Council and the volunteers there, they don't treat them bad.
Mm-hmm.
They love them. They help them, and that's what made me want to volunteer. To say, you know what, I have that compassion. I have that love. I want to be able to help these people.
Mm-hmm.
And like I said, it's not just one class. It's a lot of people
right.
of different races that come in and they mm-hmm. don't know how to read.
Right.
I have a statistic here that I got when I was reading about this. It says that 800 million people in the world cannot read or write.
Wow.
Mm-hmm. That's a lot of people.
That is a lot of people.
That is,
you know,
a lot of people.
We incorporated volunteerism mm-hmm. and reading. We incorporate all the
right.
love. We incorporate all those things together. And, you know, something as small as volunteering to go read to a kindergarten class or a
right.
third grade class or whatever. Do it. Have fun with it. Go in character. Make it exciting.
Yes.
Make it something that they really enjoy for themselves, so maybe they will pick up the habit more for themselves. And they see adults that care,
mm-hmm.
you know, right. that they can read.
Yeah, mm-hmm. and that's one thing I do with my Sunday school class, well, my Bible study class, because I teach in Bible study now. I used to teach Sunday school, but now I'm doing Wednesday night Bible class. But I go into character. I make it fun for them. You know, if they read it, then I just like, yeah, and David was doing this, and David. And they're just all like, yeah, you know, and it just kept, you know, captured their mind, and they're, you got to make it more interesting.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why I have to listen to audiobooks, y'all, because just me sitting there reading it. I mean, don't get me wrong, I will read, but audiobooks, it just helps me. I just like the excitement of it, and then they're like, and then boom, you
the
know,
general,
in the background.
Yeah, exactly.
I like, you know, mm-hmm. I don't know, it's just me, I like excitement.
How can we make, let's see, how can I put this, a question. I'm having a dyslexic moment here.
That's okay.
With Spanish.
Go ahead.
But what can we do to encourage children to read? And most important of all, to encourage reading, to encourage children to read the Bible.
Mm-hmm.
You mentioned that you had cassette player and that mm-hmm. you had the little cassette stories about
Samson,
the Bible.
Goliath.
That's
a way mm-hmm. that we can encourage, because you have it in a book.
Right.
You see that dynamic, this, you see, sorry.
That's okay.
El dinamismo. How dynamic it is. You see how the adventure of
yeah.
it. And that you could say, see, this story is also here
right.
in this book.
That's what
it's called, the Bible.
Mm-hmm.
So that's one thing. Mm-hmm. I think it's also important that families get together
yeah.
and have reading time.
Yeah.
You know, and sometimes, like, we also can have game times,
mm-hmm.
you know, that we do that and a movie night,
mm-hmm.
you know, or whatever. Well, reading time could be something that we can do. What else would you all suggest?
Well, I was going to say that definitely with children,
mm-hmm.
you reward them.
Yes.
Now, it's a lady that comes in, and, you know, I talk to everybody. But I love how she does it, because what they have to do is they have to read the book that's on their level.
Mm-hmm.
Then they have to write a small book report to make sure that they read, you know, the book.
Mm-hmm.
And then what she does at the end of the month, she rewards them
mm-hmm.
because she doesn't have a lot of money.
Mm-hmm.
So she may take them to the movie. She has a jar where they can pull out what they want to do.
Right.
So it encourages them to read, and while they're doing it, they're learning, right. And they get to spend time. But it also shows her that, you know, I'm making a difference in my children's life. Also, I was going to say that definitely at the library, they do the summer reading program every year. Mm-hmm. We do that every year for adults. I know that we're saying, how can you get children to be encouraged, but also with adults. We have a book club at the library. Mm-hmm. We have luncheon with books. That's once a month. They feed the public, and then they talk about the book at hand. So it's a lot of things that you can do, that we can do, to encourage each other. And I was going to say to parents, I know that my sisters and myself, and my mother definitely too, we have a book and we read to the kids at least once a week. My sisters do it at least once a night. They read to them once a night. So if you take a book, you know, you can check them out at the library, or you can get them at Walmart or whatever, just once a night before they go to bed. Mm-hmm. When they grow up, they will remember that.
Right.
And then, go ahead.
I'm glad you said that, because I want to ask a question. And I remember this when I was younger, the books that I used to read. So I want y'all to just think of a book that y'all read when y'all was younger.
I thought about the same thing, too.
Okay, yeah, so I can remember. I mean, I can just remember either one. I can remember reading the whole series of The Babysitter's Club. Mm. That was like, I love The Babysitter's Club. So I read the whole series.
You're not going to know the one I read.
Well, it's fine, but you can still say this. Somebody going to know the one.
I have this image of my mother and I laying in the bed together reading Marianela, which was a Spanish novel. And crying at the very end because she died. And I just, my mother and I was just boohooing. Anyway,
what about you, Missus?
Well, I remember Pokey Puppy. Pokey Puppy. That goes way.
Oh, Gregor!
You don't remember Pokey Puppy?
No, ma'am. No,
and listen. Dick and Jane. You know, Dick and Jane did everything. Yeah, and who was the dog?
I think I watched
it. It was the first. It was in no.
Spot. I was there. I was racing for
the Spot. Well, Spot. Spot. Maybe it was Spot.
Yeah.
But Dick and Jane did everything. But they usually did it in 2-word increments.
Yeah.
Hi, Dick. Hi, Jane. How are you?
I am fine.
Let me tell you something. The version of that in Puerto Rico is Pepin, Lobo, y Fini.
So, so you had Dick and Jane.
Lobo was the dog. And Pepin and Fini were the parents. I had some of those too in a different name.
I'm trying to think.
What about
of
you,
the,
Jessica?
I'm trying to think. It was always the little golden books. Dick and Jane. Definitely, because that was first grade books for us. I remember that.
Yeah.
And so, but I love the Berenstain Bears.
I did too.
I love it. And I found one the other day, y'all, and I'm about to be 36, and I was reading the mess out of that book.
I'm going to tell you something. That's Dr. Seuss, y'all. Yes. I used to love
it. We just had Dr. Seuss week last week, honey.
Did y'all?
I had a list here of some books that I recommended are all-time classics for children, like Goodnight Moon by Margaret Brown. This was written in 1947.
That's Bob. That's even before me.
That's the full Spot now.
The Very Hungry Caterpillar.
Yes.
By Eric.
So Hungry Caterpillar.
The Hungry Caterpillar. It says, Where the Wild Things Are.
Yeah, I remember that one.
Mm-hmm. The Cat in the Hat.
Yes. That whole, so I remember that now.
Charlotte's Web.
Yes, I remember that.
Harold and the Purple Crayon.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, we got that at the library now. And that's
Charlie
got a
and
lot.
The Chocolate Factory.
Yes, I read that.
This is your time, Sue. The Little Women from 1880.
Yes, Little Women. I remember Little Women.
I love that kind of stuff. Uh-huh. See, I like things from the era type of thing. Period pieces. Harry Potter, The Chronicles of Narnia.
Mm-hmm.
It's one of the most recent ones that are for children, you know, 9 and older, like that. So those are some of the books that I've found that were in or have not lost that in thing, cool thing, you know, that are still to buy. I want to say something really interesting. Books are expensive. I mean, books have gotten to be like 11, 12, 13.
Yes.
Children's book, not talking about an adult book, you know. So I don't know if you all have been to the Goodwill store, the bookstore in Tupelo. The Goodwill store in Tupelo has just a bookstore, it's all books, nothing else. The most expensive book is like $4.99.
Wow.
And the cheapest one is 99 cents. You might find something for 50 cents. So they got a whole section for children. Mm-hmm. In the very back, the whole back of the store is just children. Then they have a whole section of spiritual, religious things. So if you want any devotional Bibles, it's, you would not believe, all the books in very good conditions.
Okay.
And they have just...
Now, what is this?
This is in Tupelo, and don't ask me the road. I think it's...
McCullough.
Mm-hmm. At the very end of McCullough. Mm-hmm. You just get it there, and it's at the very end on the right side. They got the reading, your CDs, audiobooks. They have CDs. They got craft. They have classics. They have just, you would not
all
believe.
Kind of stuff.
I go, like, Bill and I go about maybe twice a month, and we stack up, and for $50, we bring like a many books. So I recommend, if you want to find a book, or if you like to read and you want to read to your children, or you want just for pleasure, read any sort of thing, go to the Goodwill store, the bookstore in Tupelo.
And but I don't y'all do something at the library?
Yeah,
I'm sorry, I keep saying that.
Go
ahead.
I was just going to say, and I recommend the library. Mm-hmm. You all, I promise, I would have never thought in a million years that I'd be sitting here talking about working at the library and recommending the library, but the Lord knows where He wants you to be.
Yes.
And I recommend that too, because you can get up to 25 books, and you know, for you and the kids, and you can have them out for 2 weeks. If you need any more time, you can renew those books. Also, you know, it doesn't cost anything to get a library card. It's a lot of people that I realize that don't even have library cards, and it costs nothing. Mm. It costs nothing to get a library card. So I recommend to get
Let me ask you this. Do y'all not have like a place in there that y'all have free books?
Mm-hmm. It's called Book Nook. Yes, ma'am.
Yes. Yes. Well, how does that work?
Well, what you do is, you know, you don't buy them. You donate to the library. Mm-hmm. So you can get as many books as you would like, and you just drop, you know, the little money or your money into the little donation box, and that goes back to the library for the fixings and different things that we have going on. Uh-huh. And we have several, several children's books in there too.
And you know, there's several civic groups that target reading and sharing of books. This, in the past couple of years, being a member of the Union County Republican Women's Club, we have targeted book collections. Mm-hmm. And within our group and from friends also, we have collected 1 year over 900 books, and then we collected 500 books. And with these, we targeted the K through 3 age group because they're always needing supplemental mm-hmm. books. All the county schools around, but we tried to choose the ones that were maybe underperforming and mm-hmm. needed more help with resources, mm-hmm. and we were able to divide these books in various counties, mm-hmm. Tippah County, Panola County, Union County, Benton County. So, and this year the College Republicans are also doing that, mm-hmm. and so we have that as a way to disseminate books.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's really good. I think that anything you can do for Christmas, for birthdays, give a book.
Mm-hmm.
Give a book.
All right. So you all, this was a really good topic, and we're glad that we were able to discuss this with you. If you all don't know, you know, how to read, definitely go to the Literacy Council, and speak with someone. There are volunteers and people that would love to help you. Come to the library, see me, get you a book, go to Goodwill. Anybody else, mm-hmm. we know we can get it. And I tell you what, just call us or write to us if you have any concerns or anything. Write to us here, okay? And we're going to pray, if you all don't mind. Mm-hmm. And if you all don't mind, I would like to do the praying today.
Go ahead.
All right. Dear Lord, Heavenly Father, God, we thank you, Lord, for today, God. We thank you, Lord, for expanding our minds, God, as we talked about reading, God.
Yes.
We thank you, Lord, for all that you've done, God. Please bless the ones that don't know how to read, God. Give them the courage to come forth to say that they want to do better, God.
Yes.
Bless the parents with their children, God. Bless the children in school, God. Just bless everybody, God. And we thank you and we love you, God. In Jesus' name we pray. Thank God. Amen.
Amen.
See you.
Bye.
See you later.
See you next time.
Read a book.